The semiconductor industry is highly volatile. The booms follow the bust with frightening speed. These are not normal times, but even in normal times, conditions are unpredictable. Semiconductor shipments can soar 70% one year and crash 40% the next. In this video, I want to think about the semiconductor business cycle. Right now, we are working through a big chip shortage. I wonder how soon before that turns into a glut. With everyone racing to build or expand their fabs, maybe sooner than we might think. But I do want to note, don't expect me to make any this year or that year predictions in this video, just presenting a bunch of scattered thoughts. Let us start by looking at the dynamics of demand and supply. But first, I want to take the time to ask you, again, to subscribe to the Asianometry newsletter. The newsletter, it gets you started with some of the best hits, along with new commentary. Some of my favorites include the ones on African swine fever, Hikvision, media tech, and more. You can find the link to the newsletter in the video description below, or you can just go to asianometry.com. You can expect a new newsletter every Thursday at 1 a.m. Taiwan time. Much thanks. When things are planned out well, then capacity can be forecasted, shortages avoided, and everything will be fine. The chairman of Foxconn said this recently about the recent shortages. Since most of the customers we serve are large customers, they all have proper precautionary planning. Therefore, the impact on these large customers is there, but limited. Of course, the hard part is the actual forecasting. End users do not directly buy microchips in large quantities. Instead, the chips are purchased by vendors who put them in consumer goods like PCs and smartphones that the users then buy. These chips don't last long on the proverbial shelves. There is always a new product coming out this or next season that threatens to make your current iteration obsolete. Missing an annual launch cycle like what happened with AMD in the mid-2000s can have dire consequences for the whole company. For more information on that, you can watch my video about AMD and TSMC. So foundry customers are always wanting to get their stuff made and shipped yesterday. Their concerns about securing stock in uncertain times can lead them to double book orders, which means exactly what it sounds like. TSMC chairman Mark Liu cites double booking as one of the major reasons why the shortage is not as bad as it looks. He blames this double booking on a number of very legitimate reasons: the pandemic and the recent China-America trade tensions, the latter of which is the bigger concern. No end in sight for that one, so we should expect some double booking to continue. Demand is also heavily impacted by the greater macroeconomy. It makes sense. Electronics are consumer items, and consumers buy fewer iPhones and laptops when times are tough. For instance, three downturns in the recent semiconductor business cycle can be attributed to oil shocks in 1975, 1982, and 1991. And then there's a fourth from the Asian financial crisis of 1998. Everyone might be howling about semiconductor shortages right now, but we forget that in March of 2020, the stock market was down 25% and experts were saying that the world economy was falling to bits. Back then, companies were doing all that they can to cut their expenses and hunker down. But a flurry of stimulus packages and money printing meant that the economy bounced back faster than anyone ever anticipated in Q3 2020. I don't think me or anyone else could have predicted that that would happen. So that is the macro, and everyone talks about macro, but here's something interesting. A study in 2005 found that what is more significant in the triggering of semiconductor down cycles is not a decrease in demand. Rather, it has more to do with surges in semiconductor inventory levels and fab capacity. In other words, oversupply rather than under demand. This makes sense to me. It's not like foundries and semiconductor companies have never heard of the business cycle, but rather the nature and economics of the industry force them to make like rabbits until the whole thing collapses. First, let us start with a fab. A fab costs a lot of money to build. We all know about Moore's Law, not an actual, natural law, but rather an industry observation that the number of transistors on an integrated circuit doubles every 2 years. It's famous and everyone likes to talk about it. But not as well known is Moore's second law, also known as Rock's Law, named after one of Intel's early investors. It states that the cost of semiconductor tools doubles every 4 years. Such tools represent 75% of the total cost of the fab, driving them upwards. In 2000, a leading-edge fab cost $1 billion, twice as much as it was in 1995. In 2005, $3 billion. Now, in 2020, TSMC's leading-edge N5 fab in Tainan cost roughly $17 billion. Its next-generation N3 process fab, also in Tainan, is estimated to cost $19.5 billion. Like with Moore's law itself, Rock's law is an observation and not a natural law. As much research goes into slowing Rock's law as it does into accelerating Moore's. And there are a few techniques and financial methods that companies have explored in reducing those costs, though they have their own trade-offs. Regardless, foundries still have to put up billions of dollars before they can even start to compete. And that therein lies the problem. Most foundries would like their new billion-dollar fabs to make back their billion-dollar investments. But with the way the chip market is, those fabs start losing value almost right away. It is like what they say about driving a new car off of the lot. Much of these fab construction costs are fixed, but the marginal cost of making another chip is basically nil, so you want to make and sell as many chips as possible to amortize out those fixed costs. What happens is that supply hits the market, exceeds demand, and prices collapse. Everyone starts making less profit. Market supply should pull back. But the foundries are incentivized to sell every chip that they can possibly make. If they can generate even a bit of gross profit that can contribute to their future survival costs, they sell. Furthermore, the industry's titans, Samsung and TSMC, value market share over profitability. They refuse to mothball capacity lest that business go to any potential competitors. And because they have massive economies of scale, they can cause the market price to plunge to essentially their survival price, which is far lower than everyone else's in the industry. The result is a fierce down cycle that burns out the lower performers. Companies go bankrupt and get bought out, supply rebalances with demand, and the cycle resets itself once more, waiting for the next chip shortage. As they say in the Romance of the Three Kingdoms, the empire, long divided, must unite, long united, must divide. The cycle. I want to talk a bit about subsidies. There have been a lot of chatter in the news about governments putting down cash to build fabs. China's doing it with their $20 billion semiconductor plan, President Joe Biden included $50 billion in his stimulus plan, and the EU is putting together 145 billion euro for a 2-nanometer cutting-edge fab of their own. I can't address all that I wanted to say here, but I want to get to some essential points. Let's start with the US, and I'll have something for the EU and China later. In the US, there are two significant pieces of US legislation in the works, the CHIPS Act and the American Foundries Act. They would establish an R&D fund and a 20-40% tax credit for the acquisition of semiconductor production equipment. I think the tax credit's effects would be shorter term, impacting 3 to 5 years or one fab generation. On the other hand, I like the R&D fund, which I think will have longer term lasting effects, especially when it comes to spinning off public-private partnerships like the one that created EUV. I thus have mixed feelings about the whole venture. I understand the value of natural sovereignty, government involvement and investment in certain high priority things. I recognize that I've written a lot about TSMC in Taiwan and thus might harbor biases. By now, you probably have already decided for yourself whether or not I am some sort of shill or otherwise, but do your own research, do your own thinking, blah blah blah. But I personally am also a big believer in commercial things having to eventually pay for themselves. Like with every other government action, subsidies create distortions. That's the whole point of having them. The subsidy's intention is to bring more manufacturing to the United States. It looks like they will get their wish. 40% subsidies can do that. But unless the subsidies go on forever, and they might, the government spent money on dumber stuff before, the subsidized fab should have to stand up on their own 2 feet afterwards. We will need to go back to Congress to get those credits renewed, right? I bet then, it gets a lot more scrutiny, especially once the politically powerful automakers get their chips back, the F-150s are back on the lots again, and we are on to the next crisis. I'm doing this video because today we are in the midst of a large build-out of fabs and fab capacity across the world. Fabs are so hot right now. TSMC is working on its Arizona fab that's been going on for a year now. And there have been whispers that this small 20,000 wafer fab is being upscaled in size from the original plan. Samsung is in negotiations on a major investment build-out of their Austin fab. They're going to spend tens of billions of dollars on that as well. And even the smaller second-tier foundries are building out or upgrading their fab capacity. There has been a flurry of press releases from all of these companies, none of whom with a process node under 10 nanometer, about new sites and projects. Global Foundries is spending $1.4 billion in expansion and moving up their IPO. Maybe they need the capital. Maybe their Middle East investors think that they should strike while the iron is hot and cash out their shares. Just thinking. And SMIC is getting money from the Shenzhen government to build a $2.35 billion project. That wafer fab is expected to do 40,000 wafers a month once it's done in 2022. Just a small sample of the recent news going on in the semiconductor world. And my immediate thoughts on that is that it's a whole lot of capacity. For instance, once TSMC completes its Arizona fab, the new facility will have about 25,000 to 100,000 wafer starts a month, depending on the final size they decide. Along with everyone else, that is hundreds of thousands of wafers coming to the market over the next 1 to 2 years. It would be irrational to say that that won't have any effect on the market once that capacity is all built. Did we really create tens of millions of chips worth of demand over the past year? Now people are starting to go back to school and the office. Are PC master race types or crypto miners buying that many new graphics cards and motherboards? I doubt it. And the American government's not going to buy all those chips. The Department of Defense buys 1.9 billion semiconductors a year. Sounds like a lot, but if the TSMC Arizona fab does 50,000 wafers a month, which is a middle estimate, that alone is a theoretical 3.5 billion dies a month. 1 month. So, I'm watching this build-out with some interest and curiosity. The chip shortage has been in the Wall Street Journal and The Verge for a really long time. It's basically public knowledge by now. Semis are super, super hot. But I wonder how long this boom will last, and when the bust will inevitably happen. Alright, thanks for watching, that's all for now. Just some random thoughts I threw together. If you want more content, you can subscribe to the channel, and the YouTube algorithm will recommend a bunch of Asianometry videos to you in the feed. I hope you enjoy them. I also certainly cannot do a video ending without again reminding you to hit up the email newsletter. Want to send me an email? Drop me a line at john@asianometry.com. I love getting letters from viewers. Until next time, I'll see you guys later.